What's up, you guys? It's me, Marin. I'm back with another Scary Saturday video, and this week's video is going to be named Mysterious Celebrity Deaths. And I'm going to be talking about five in this video and five in my next video next week. Let's go ahead and jump right into this video. The first person that we're going to be talking about is going to be Aaliyah. Aaliyah was a beloved Brooklyn-born Detroit-raised singer who rose to her fame through her debut album, Age is Nothing But a Number. She tragically passed away on August 25, 2001 at 6:50 p.m. Aaliyah and a few other people, they all went out of country to record what would now be known as Aaliyah's last video, Rock the Boat. They were originally supposed to leave the day after, but they all just really, really wanted to go home that exact same day because I guess they were just eager to get back to the United States. So they left the same day after filming. They got another plane that was a little bit smaller than the plane that they were originally supposed to ride on. They all boarded up there, and I believe it was about 200 feet after they left the little runway, the plane crashed and blew up. And people say that the pilot that was controlling that plane was actually high on cocaine. And yeah, so a lot of people in the industry and a lot of fans and people that just like R&B music, they were all extremely heartbroken to hear about her death because she was an extremely popular music artist. A lot of people were extremely heartbroken. A conspiracy is that some people actually wanted her dead. No, man. Okay, you know, let's just go ahead and jump right into this conspiracy that I'm going to be talking about. You know why and how she died. But let's just start with Aaliyah's connection to Jay-Z. So it was an extremely big rumor that Aaliyah and Jay-Z dated. Now, Jay-Z and Damon Dash both have said that Aaliyah and Jay-Z knew each other before Damon Dash and Aaliyah met or even started dating. And, but Damon Dash did admit that Jay-Z tried to get with Aaliyah. They never have like a time stamp of when he tried to get with Aaliyah, but I know that Jay-Z and Beyonce, I guess, have been talking since she was 18, like 1999, and Jay-Z said something about they started dating in 1997, but Beyonce said they started dating in 1999. So if that is true, then it would kind of make sense that Beyonce would be a little bit jealous of Aaliyah because you could honestly tell that Beyonce was like a young girl, like head over heels in love with Jay-Z, you know, her boyfriend or whatever, and he tried to get with Aaliyah, so that would probably build a little bit of animosity. And we all know the humongous rumor about Jay-Z and Beyonce being the leaders of the Illuminati and whatnot. Who's to say that his best friend at the time wasn't also in the Illuminati? And who's to say that Aaliyah didn't find her way into that group? And that's part of the theory, that Aaliyah found her way into the Illuminati and realized that that's not what she was about and that's not what she wanted to do. And she wanted out, and they didn't like that much. So she basically expected them to come for her. And like, the biggest piece of evidence is listening to Rock the Boat, which was her last music video she recorded backwards, which is a really popular thing that producers do, is they'll put subliminal messages in a song, and you know, it'll be either you can hear it backwards or you can hear like somebody like whispering with the beat saying something. Okay, first let's talk about the video. So in the video, it was just like such a beautiful angelic look. Like, she had on all white, like you know, she's dancing on the boat, and it was just really beautiful. And then she was underwater, and it was just like looking like she was like descending up to heaven and stuff like that. Like, you know, like, people think that that's a you know, some symbolism. Mm-hmm. And I also think that when you listen to the song backwards, you hear Aaliyah saying, "I cannot be pushed, you thought I would. My life isn't through." Just weird stuff. Like, the creepiest part is where Aaliyah says, "You wanted Beyonce," and stuff like that. Like, basically saying that the Illuminati wanted Beyonce. And it's just so creepy because the song was made in 2001, or maybe even before then. Like, she's talking about how they wanted Beyonce. And it's just really, really weird. Like, and yeah, like, a lot of people think that it was like an inside job from, you know, like, Jay-Z is a pretty powerful person. I'm not sure if he was that powerful back then, but he's extremely powerful now. And if those rumors about him wanting Aaliyah out and like them wanting her gone and whatnot, if those were true, then he kind of would have enough power to like turn the people that were working for her against her and stuff like that. People think it has something to do with her wanting out of the Illuminati and Jay-Z and her ex not liking that. And people think that it has something to do with Beyonce being jealous and wanting that spot. Yeah, it's just a really sad story. And like I said at the beginning of this video is not intended to disrespect anybody. It's not intended to disrespect the person that I'm talking about, the people involved, and definitely not their families. It's just conspiracy theories and things that I know. But yeah, so the next person that we're going to be talking about is an R&B group called Damien and Dean. Damien Dame was an American R&B duo who enjoyed a brief period of success in the early 1990s before tragedy cut their career short. The group consisted of Deborah Hurd, who is Dame, and Bruce Brodus, who is Damien. The duo rose to fame when they released their self-titled debut singles, Right Down to It and Exclusivity, in the early 90s. So they're people who known about them, but like they were just starting to rise to fame when they died. They weren't famous for that long, so not too much about their personal life was known. Like, they weren't extremely, extremely big, but a lot of people knew about their music and a lot of people knew about them. So I'm not trying to take away from their legacies. They were pretty well known, but they weren't able to get as big as, you know, like other people in that time. And you know, it wasn't too much known about their personal life, so it was pretty hard for me to get to it. Yeah, let's just go ahead and jump into their deaths. Dame died June 27, 1994. She died in a car accident. The rumor is that she passed away leaving a former singer named Pebbles' house. And a lot of people think this woman is extremely sketchy. She's really known for being the reason that TLC went bankrupt. A lot of people think she was extremely sketchy, extremely money hungry and things like that. So a lot of people really do trust her. But yeah, so that's really what she was known for. And the Dame passed away supposedly leaving her house, which is extremely sketchy and stuff like that. And the car crash, they say, was so bad that Dame was almost decapitated. And Damien also passed away, but he passed away June 27th. He passed away two years to the exact same day that she passed away. He passed away from colon cancer, though. And people think that it was a rumor that if their record label didn't have anything to do with their deaths, then he might have been on the DL. He died of AIDS. So, yeah. I don't know. That's kind of just like a stupid rumor, though. Just because, you know, the way he did his hair or the way he dressed or something like that, that'd be the reason why they, a lot of people that I seen on a chat room talking about it, they said that it was a rumor that he passed away of HIV or AIDS or something like that. But that's a stretch. So let's just go ahead and jump into the conspiracy theory. So the record label that they were signed with at the time was really sketchy. They did a lot of bad business. They had a lot of bad blood and stuff like that with the people. You know, I did my research on them, and they kind of had some bad beef with a lot of people because, you know, they like to play with people's money and whatnot. And I heard that they took advantage of, you know, a few people who were, you know, kind of young and they didn't know much about the music industry. So I heard that they took advantage of people like them and whatnot. So I think that that whole label was pretty sketchy. So I don't know, that could be something to do with their deaths, but ultimately I don't know. And yeah, gonna move on to the next one. The next one is this is a really disturbing case. This next one is gonna be on Sean and Gerald Levert. Sean Edward Levert was an Ohio-born singer, best known as the member of R&B vocal group Levert. Sean Levert was the son of OJ singer Eddie Levert and younger brother of Gerald Levert, who also ended up passing away. Before Sean Levert passed away, he was sent to jail for owing $90,000 in child support. And they sentenced him to jail for 22 months for child support. I don't know, man. He was sent to jail for that, but he ultimately didn't even end up being able to serve 7 days in jail. So before he passed away, he was hallucinating really, really bad. And he went in there with his anxiety medicine, which was Xanax, and was denied his medicine. They took his medicine away from him and refused to give it back to him. Like, they just really, they weren't taking his mental health seriously at all. Like, it was just a really disturbing case. But yeah, so he was hallucinating a lot. Like, he kind of, in a way, was like losing his mind. Like, he was just hallucinating a lot and stuff like that. And one of the worst cases of his hallucinations was he was in jail with his roommate, and he says he heard his wife say his son fell into the pool and couldn't breathe. A short time later, a corrections officer and a nurse came into Levert's cell. He was crying and just like throwing a fit. He was really, really disturbed. And they took him to the section for the mental health patients and still wasn't given his medication. And not only that, but when before they even took him there, he had breathing issues, I'm guessing. He had heart problems, which is what he ultimately died of. But yeah, he had heart problems and whatnot, and they still made him sleep on a mattress on the floor. So he, for the few days that he was there, his roommate said that he tried to sit with his back up against the wall to, you know, so he wouldn't stop breathing and stuff like that. But they took him to the mental health area, and he still wasn't given his medicine. He couldn't get an appointment to see if he really needed it or not, which is what I'm guessing that they kept it away from him because they wanted to make sure that he needed the Xanax and he wasn't just using it, like, you know, to get high and whatnot. So they really didn't take it seriously. And they told the police that the reason that he wasn't given his medicine was because that anxiety was not taken as a serious, wasn't taken seriously. You know, they didn't think that it was an emergency. They also said that about psychosis, schizophrenic, and suicidal thoughts. Another time where he was hallucinating was a time where one of the people that was working there says that they just heard him screaming, like just yelling to the top of his lungs, crying, banging on the floor, and it sounded like he was being attacked. The guy McClellan, he was the officer that interviewed a lot. He says that once he opened the door, Levert shot into his arm. He didn't put up a fight, but I'm guessing when he shot into his arms that they both fell to the ground, and McClellan put him into handcuffs. They began strapping him down and restraining him so he doesn't hurt himself or anyone else. And a nurse went to go check on him where he was having a moment. Yeah, he was still in really bad condition. So the nurse went and told the jail psychiatrist that he wasn't doing well. She told the nurse to inject him with Benadryl, Ativan, and Haldol to calm him down. And the nurse told McClellan, the officer that she wanted to see a little bit on his mental health history before she would give him the injection. So they called his mom and assured her that he was fine and that he was just having a hard time adjusting, basically, when that's not even the case. Like, he was full-blown breaking down. So they went back and they checked on him again, where he was having a hard time breathing, and then eventually he just stopped breathing, and they were sitting there trying to do CPR on him, and luckily there was already EMS in the jail facility who was trying to help out somebody else who also was having a hard time breathing. They rushed him to the hospital where they tried getting his heart to start again for 15 minutes, and that didn't work, and he passed away March 30th, 2007 at 11:57 p.m. And like, when his wife and stuff found out about it, she was honestly really irritated. She was really mad, and like, you know, she was just really mad. So she ended up suing him and making sure that there was no foul play involved and stuff like that, which it wasn't. But his mental health was just not taken well. You know, they didn't care about it, which ultimately ended in his death. So they say he died of sarcoidosis, which is basically just a disease where it causes inflammation with some of your organs, mainly your lungs. And then he also died of high blood pressure, heart disease, diabetes, and withdrawal from Xanax, which is the medicine he was begging for, basically. McClellan was the guy that was telling us most of the stuff, and he said that people that worked there, they honestly felt really guilty and cute, including himself, and they had a hard time coping with watching somebody about to, you know, pass away. And people from the psych unit actually didn't even come to work the next day. But yeah, and Gerald Levert was his brother, and he also passed away. He was taking some medicine pain because he had surgery on his Achilles tendon, and he was also taking a few other medicine. They called it a cocktail of medicine inside of his bloodstream. They said that they found painkillers like Vicodin, Percocet, Darmocet, in addition to Xanax and two other antihistamines. They did his autopsy and they found out that he overdosed, which is really, really sad. And yeah, so people think that is a such thing as a Levert curse, and I don't think so, because I mean, they both just passed away. So sad they passed away with their moms, but I mean, I don't think it's a curse or anything. I just thought it was really weird, and it might be a little bit more to how they died. And our final, last, but most definitely not least, is Amy Winehouse. Amy Winehouse was an English singer-songwriter known for her soulful voice and her raw lyrics. Amy rose to fame in the UK with her debut album, Frank, which is a really, really good album. And she rose to fame in the US with the album Back to Black, with one of her most famous songs being Rehab. So Amy Winehouse passed away July 23rd, 2011. She was having a hard time dealing with addiction, drug addiction, alcoholism, and stuff like that, you know. They say that they think that she had mental issues and stuff like that. And yeah, so she also was bulimic and stuff like that. So her health was really, really not the best, you know. She got clean of drugs earlier. I forgot how long she had been clean before she passed away. But, you know, she was really proud of herself. She was telling people that, you know, she was clean and she was working on not drinking alcohol anymore. And yeah, so she was doing pretty well. But the night she died, her security guard said that she was inside of her room and she was watching videos of herself, which she said she hadn't done in a really long time. And she seemed happy and stuff like that, so he didn't really worry about her. And he said that he could tell that she had been drinking, but she didn't seem belligerent or anything. So she went back upstairs, and he assumed she went to sleep. He went up there, checked on her, and she was asleep. He came back like a bunch of hours later, and she was still in position, and he realized she had passed away. That's what happened from her security guard's point of view. But her next door neighbor said that before she had died, that he had heard yelling and howling and drum beats, which is going to bring me into my conspiracy on Amy Winehouse, which is that she was a part of the 27 Club. And a few things that go along with this was she was 27 when she passed away, and she passed away with the same circumstances as a few other people who also passed away at 27 and are believed to be a part of the 27's Club. And for example, Kurt Cobain also passed away at the age of 27. He was also into drugs and stuff, so he kind of had that rebel reputation, but he killed himself. That's the only difference. But you know, they were in the same kind of circumstances. And actually, this thing that made me kind of like, you know, think about it a little bit more was that Kurt Cobain's mom said now he's gone and he's joined that dumb club. I begged him not to join that dumb club. So of course, if she begged him not to join the club, then that means that he had to know about it and that he did it willingly. And you know, people think that maybe Amy Winehouse, you know, chose the same fate. People also think that if it's not willingly, the devil reaches out to people that seem the most vulnerable and easy to, you know, self-destruct and take them away at 27. Like, a lot of people in the 27 Club, they are extremely similar. Like, they were all super talented. They didn't have the best childhoods, you know, kind of unstable parents. Labeled as strange or disturbed. They were extremely honest and raw, and they struggled with addiction and just blatantly didn't care about their life and began to disregard their health, which is the case for Amy Winehouse as well. A lot of people just think that that's just like a little bit of proof that they were all like chosen by the devil and wanted them. He lured them in, offered them fame and a happy life, and then in return gave them depression and just a bunch of messed up stuff and took their lives away from them at 20. Well, actually, kind of didn't take their lives away from them, but like let them choose to take their lives. Like, once she died, like a lot of people were like, oh yeah, we were kind of expecting her to die. You know, she overdosed on drugs. But they were wrong, because she actually was clean on drugs and they didn't find any illegal drugs in her system, but they did find an extremely high amount of alcohol, which she knew would kill her because she had been hospitalized for before and was told that if she drank again that, you know, she would eventually die. So she clearly, you know, was ready to go. And another weird thing is that she had to have two autopsies, because the first one had to be redone because the person who did her first autopsy actually wasn't even qualified enough. And then her dad also said that wasn't even the first mistake that they made. The first mistake that they made was that they sent her autopsy to the wrong house, which is like, what? Like, why? Like, how did you even do that? Like, how did you screw up that bad that you would send somebody's autopsy to the wrong place? And then so once they got the second autopsy, they found out that she actually died of alcohol poisoning due to the high amount of alcohol she had in her body. So yeah, I'm gonna end this video right here. I'm gonna have 5 more celebrities. It'll be a lot more organized and a lot more information, and just like, it'll be a much better video than this one. This is actually my first type of video like this, and I love watching videos like this, so I wanted to make one, and I enjoy making it and researching it. But this week has been pretty hectic for me. So yeah, next week's video will be extremely better. And I just want to say thank you guys so much for watching. Please make sure you guys like, comment, and subscribe. And please share to help us grow. And I'll see you guys later.